Random House Audio presents 10 Billion by Stephen Emmott, read for you by Jonathan Cowley. This is a book about us. It's a book about you, your children, your parents, your friends. It's about every one of us. It's about our failure. Failure as individuals, the failure of business, and the failure of our politicians. It's about the unprecedented planetary emergency we've created. It's about the future of us. Earth is home to millions of species. Just one dominates it, us. Our cleverness, our inventiveness, and our activities have modified almost every part of our planet. In fact, we are having a profound impact on it. Indeed, our cleverness, our inventiveness, and our activities are now the drivers of every global problem we face. And every one of these problems is accelerating as we continue to grow toward a population of 10 billion. In fact, I believe we can rightly call the situation we're in right now an emergency, an unprecedented planetary emergency. This is the reason I have written this book. I am a scientist. I lead a lab in Cambridge, England, which is home to a unique collection of amazing young scientists. We conduct research into complex systems, including the climate system and ecosystems, as well as the impact of us humans on the Earth. Science is ultimately about understanding, and this is what we try to do, to understand the Earth's climate and the behavior of the Earth's terrestrial and marine ecosystems, from its microbial communities to its forests, and to predict how these vital planetary systems will respond to change, change caused by us. We humans emerged as a species about 200,000 years ago. In geological time, that is really incredibly recent. Just over 10,000 years ago, there were 1 million of us. By 1800, just over 200 years ago, there were 1 billion of us. By 1960, 50 years ago, there were 3 billion of us. There are now over 7 billion of us. By 2050, your children or your children's children will be living on a planet with at least 9 billion other people. Sometime toward the end of this century, there will be at least 10 billion of us, possibly more. How did we get to where we are now? We got to where we are now through a number of civilization and society-shaping events, most notably the agricultural revolution, the scientific revolution, and in the West, the public health revolution. These events have fundamentally shaped how we live and have fundamentally shaped our planet. Their legacy will continue to shape our future. So we need to look at our growth and activities through the lens of these developments. By 1800, the global population had reached 1 billion. One of the principal reasons for this growth was the invention of agriculture. The agricultural revolution enabled us to go from being hunter-gatherers to highly organized producers of food and allowed our population to grow. A useful way to think of the development and importance of agriculture is in terms of at least three agricultural revolutions. The first took place over 10,000 years ago. This was the domestication of animals and the cultivation of plant types. The second agricultural revolution was between the 15th and 19th centuries. This was a revolution in agricultural productivity and the mechanization of food production. The third happened between the 1950s and 2000s, the so-called Green Revolution. But there's another story here. The start of a fundamental transformation of land use by humans. 130 years later, we had grown to 2 billion. It was 1930. The impact of another revolution, the Industrial Revolution, was being felt. The world was being transformed by manufacturing, technological innovation, new industrial processes, and transportation. The continuing expansion of agriculture and the revolution in public health enabled us to continue to grow rapidly. But there's another story here too. The start of our lethal addiction to coal, oil, and gas as our principal sources of energy. 30 years later, we had grown to 3 billion. It was 1960, and we were in the middle of a food revolution. There were more of us, far more of us. We needed more food, far more food. More than the established agricultural system could provide. What became known as the Green Revolution provided this extra food. It did so through the industrial-scale use of chemical pesticides, chemical herbicides, and chemical fertilizers, an unprecedented expansion of land use, and the wholesale industrialization of the entire food production system. This included the industrialization of raising and harvesting animals for food, from the rise of industrial-scale factory fishing fleets to battery farming of pigs, poultry, and beef. This revolution came at a huge cost to the environment in terms of loss of habitat, pollution, overfishing. It also set in motion an unprecedented decline of species and the start of the degradation of entire ecosystems. By 1980, 20 years later, there were 4 billion of us on the planet. The Green Revolution had produced much more food. That made food cheaper. In turn, that meant we had more money to spend, and we had started to spend it on stuff. Televisions, video recorders, Walkmans, hair dryers, cars, and clothes. And we also started to spend it on vacations, far more vacations. At the center of this spending spree was the astonishing growth of transportation. In 1960, there were 100 million cars on the world's roads. By 1980, there were 300 million. With this came a massive expansion of road networks, carving up entire countries, further increasing loss of habitat for other species. In 1960, we flew 62 billion passenger miles. In 1980, we flew 620 billion passenger miles. Global shipping grew at a similarly astonishing rate. All of the stuff we were buying, plus all of the food we were consuming, plus all the raw materials and resources required to make everything was being shipped around the world. Just 10 years later, in 1990, there were 5 billion of us. By this point, initial signs of the consequences of our growth were starting to show. Not the least of these was on water. Our demand for water, not just the water we drank, but the water we needed for food production and to make all the stuff we were consuming, was going through the roof. But something was starting to happen to water. Back in 1984, journalists reported from Ethiopia about a famine of biblical proportions caused by widespread drought. That, it seemed, was over there in Africa. Except that it wasn't just happening over there in Africa. Unusual drought and unusual flooding was increasing everywhere. Australia, Asia, Europe, the United States. Water, a vital resource we had thought of as abundant, was now suddenly something that had the potential to be scarce. By the year 2000, there were 6 billion of us. By this point, it was becoming clear to the world's scientific community that the accumulation of CO2, methane, and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere as a result of agriculture, land use, and the production, processing, and transportation of everything we were consuming was changing the climate. And that, as a result, we had a serious problem on our hands. 1998 had been the warmest year on record. The 10 warmest years on record have occurred since 1998. We hear the term climate every day, so it is worth thinking about what we actually mean by it. Obviously, climate is not the same as weather. The climate is one of Earth's fundamental life support systems, one that determines whether or not we humans and millions of other species are able to live on this planet. It is generated by four components: the atmosphere, the air we breathe, The hydrosphere, the planet's water. The cryosphere, the ice sheet and glaciers. The biosphere, the planet's plants and animals. By now, our activities had started to modify every one of these components. Our emissions of CO2...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.